All right, everybody, we're live. Episode 3 of Season 2 of Just the Gi Top Podcast. So today we have Tim Spriggs from Crazy 8 MMA in Maryland. So first of all, thank you very much, Tim, for coming today.
Thanks for having me, guys. Glad to be on the show.
Our normal podcast members, we have Ahmed Tirani.
Hello, everyone. Yeah, good afternoon, hey. Good evening, depending where you are.
Yeah. Rami Tirani's absent tonight. He's in, where is he? Portland?
He's in Portland, man. I don't know why you'd want to go to Portland, but there's something going on there, I guess. So, yeah, he can't join us today.
I guess.
Tim, do you know anyone in Portland? Are we offending anyone before?
No, I don't know anybody in Portland.
Okay, there you go.
So, I don't think
we have a lot of viewers in Portland either, so I think we're probably safe here. So just to go over a couple things, just some of Tim's accomplishments in case you don't know who he is. Tim's won gold in at Purple World's No-Gi Pans twice, I think, right, Tim? Euros, Division and Open. Recently this year, Brown Heavy Gold in Worlds, Bronze in Brown Open. You won gold at Pans this year, right? And and silver in the open class, correct?
It was a closeout. Yeah. It was a closeout.
Nice. So technically, yeah. Tim's a big name on the competition scene right now. So maybe, Tim, if we could get started, just kind of let us know about how you got into jiu-jitsu and kind of what that journey's been like for you so far.
All right. So I started doing jiu-jitsu when I was 16 years old. You know, I played other sports growing up. I was mainly like a football guy. And in high school, I sucked. I was terrible. Didn't make the transition from little league to high school. And I tried karate for a little bit afterwards. And I saw the first season of Ultimate Fighter. And, you know, all the guys were afraid of jiu-jitsu dudes. And I was like, well, you know, jiu-jitsu is pretty good then if everybody's scared of wrestling and going to the ground with these guys. So I wanted to check it out. I did my research, and I was lucky to have Crazy 88 ran by Julius Park within about 6 minutes of my house. So from where I'm in now, it's a 6 minute drive to Crazy 88. And when I first started, I was the youngest guy there. So I was like 16 years old. I was pretty much a kid. Like, I was skinny, tall, lanky, gangly, or whatever you want to call it. And I was going in there with, like, guys in their mid-20s that were, like, in their physical prime. And, you know, I just grew up in the fire, so to speak, you know. So that's how I started.
All right, everybody, we're live. Episode 3 of Season 2 of Just the
Gi-Top
Podcast.
Sorry,
so today we have Tim Spriggs from
I just
Crazy
have the...
MMA.
It's on a delay.
Get us
together,
man.
No, give me a second. Sorry.
Guys.
Okay, it's off. Sorry, guys. So, yeah, like I said, there's like about a 20-second delay when we go live. Okay, yeah, no, Tim, so Crazy 88, tell us now. You work there full-time, I believe, right now?
Yeah. I teach the kids program there. I'm trying to bring up all those kids, kind of like, you know, make it so I build them up so one day they can beat me up. So that's my main job there now.
Okay.
But I train with Master Lloyd at Camp Springs 2 times a day. So I make a drive first thing in the morning. I get there about 10 a.m., train, then I drive back to Crazy 88, teach, then I go back to Camp Springs, and I train all night, and then I sleep at the fighter house up there, and wake up in the morning, train again, and go back to Crazy 88. So that's pretty much my whole day. So I'm either teaching, training, coaching, you know, doing my thing on the mat. So I'm on the mat pretty much 8 to 10 hours a day, and then I sleep.
Damn it. So, sorry, the commute is 2 hours? You do a two-hour drive?
No, it's not 2 hours. Okay. I'd say, well, it's D.C. traffic, so it's the nation's capital, so it's pretty bad. It's probably about 45 minutes, if it's really bad, an hour.
Okay. Wow. Okay.
I was just going to ask, what was it about jiu-jitsu that that attracted you versus the other sports or things that you had tried?
Well, what attracted me to jiu-jitsu was that it'd be a sport, like I'd be able to compete, but also like growing up, I got picked on a lot, so I wanted to learn a skill where push come to shove, I could just handle my business, you know, put hands on somebody, if they attacked me or something, because I'm a very passive, chill dude, you know, and like growing up, I didn't want to get in any kind of trouble. I was like a good kid, so, you know, I usually was the one picked on, so I wanted to be able to defend myself. So I like both aspects of the sport and the martial art.
Oh, okay. Just another question. I know you mentioned football, and it didn't go well for you. You said, and I'm using your words, you said you sucked.
Yeah, so,
and then, I mean, obviously, as we only listed some of your key accomplishments from 2012 till now. There's a lot more. But what changed? You went from being slow in like, let's say, football or whatever, and then in jiu-jitsu, you obviously just put it together. You're a pretty strong guy. You're a heavyweight now. You know, what helped with that transition from being gangly, skinny, whatever, to a powerhouse?
Well, I would say that when I started jiu-jitsu, before that, I never really had to work super hard for anything my whole life. You know, I never put in the effort. And I viewed jiu-jitsu as a way to prove to, like, not only myself, but to my family that I could see something through. So from day one, I put 110% effort in. So that made a huge difference as far as success. As far as, like, me getting bigger and stronger, you know, I just started to fill out into my frame. And my strength and conditioning coach, Greg Howe at Tim Spriggs, he really has helped me lately with my athleticism. So like before, like I have like athleticism in my genes. Like my dad played college football, he's like a tight end. My grandfather was like a really big college basketball player. On my grandfather, on my mom's side. So on both sides of my family, I had natural athleticism. So I just had to work for it. So what you see now is just like me starting to get into my athletic prime. So, I mean, it's only going to get better. But, yeah, I started lifting heavy. And, you know, when we first started at 88 doing strength and conditioning, we did CrossFit. And that helped me get really strong.
Like, Okay.
That was cool, you know. Yeah. I like to always say that. So, but now I do real lifting.
Yeah, so... You know what? Can you take us through a day? You pretty much told us you're on the mats 8 to 10 hours a day. Can you take us through a typical routine, like drilling, weightlifting, sparring, etc.?
All right. So it depends on the day. So like a typical day would be 10 a.m. I get to practice and we do wrestling since it's nobody season. So I do wrestling with Coach Greg. He does the strength and conditioning as well as the wrestling. So we do a lot of wrestling. My main training partners right now are Gobi Edmelson and Muhammad Ali. They won purple belt worlds last year, and they just got promoted to brown. So I'm wrestling those guys, and they're like super heavyweight and heavyweight. And I wrestle Coach Greg as well. So we're on the mat like now, like the grind for Nogi Worlds. We got these like long 3 hour, at least 3 hour practices. Like, we're doing, like, lifting, weights, and then we go right to drilling. Like, it's all a bunch of crazy stuff. Like, pretty much your typical, like, if you Google Iowa wrestling practice, mm-hmm. like, their kind of practices is, like, almost every day, twice a day. And that's just in the morning. So for 3.5 hours, probably, we do wrestling, and then I get some food, and I drive to Crazy 88 to teach, and that's 2 hours of, like, teaching.
Right.
That's about 3, 4, 5 hours, maybe 6 if it's like a longer wrestling practice. And then I go back to Camp Springs, and then we got jiu-jitsu. And that's about 3 hours long, too. And on top of that, after practice, I do grip strengthening exercises, you know, and I watch film until I go to sleep.
When do you try to make time for, like, recovery? Like, how do you feel like you maintain that type of training regimen?
I just sleep, you know, sleep, and then on weekends, like Saturday morning, we train really hard, and then Sunday, I take the day off.
Nice.
But, you know, I've just embraced it, you know, like dealing with the pain, dealing with having to wake up early, eating healthy, you know, taking the proper supplements, you know, I just have gotten used to it, so... You know, I figure it's like the pain that goes with it is a part of the game, and that's going to be a difference on the long run. So, like, if I get in a tough spot in a match, you know, I'm used to being uncomfortable. So,
Yeah. What
I always believe is, like, you know, the key to being elite is being comfortable in the most uncomfortable situations. You know, you'll see a guy like Buchecha, who can get his guard passed, almost get choked out, all this crazy stuff, but he'll come back and win. And I view as that is he's comfortable in being in extremely bad situations. So me getting up every day and toughing it out, is, you know, I embrace it. So.
You're a young guy, but I mean, do you, when you're dealing with that kind of training regimen, do you have any lasting or lingering injuries or anything like that that you've had to get over?
No. I mean, I've had a serious injury before, but I have no lasting impact from it.
Like, I mean, we're all older, so we're like in our 30s. And
okay.
So, like, I think whenever Ahmed and I are training together, we're always like, you know, let's go easy on the takedowns because, you know, maybe our backs can't take it today. But, yeah, I know you're a younger guy, so I'm just wondering if you have anything like that at all.
I mean, every once in a while, I'll get banged up a little bit, and I'll take it kind of easy, but I'm a pretty reckless dude, so, like, as long as I can walk, and as long as, like, I can deal with it, I have a high tolerance of pain, I'll just keep going. Okay. But if I feel like I'm hurt bad, I'll stop. Like if I feel like something's, like, cracked or, like, something really bad, like, I gotta go to the hospital, then I'll be like, yeah, let's slow down, let me get myself checked out. Like, I, like, ruptured my colon and didn't even know it. Until like practice. Yeah. Yeah. I was like, yeah. It was,
how did that happen?
That wasn't like oil check or anything,
right? Yeah.
No. No checking the oil here. No. That's not in my repertoire. That's not my game plan. So so what happened was when I was a purple belt, my second year, that was the year I won Europeans and I won my weight class in Pan Ams. We were getting ready for Brasileiro, so the next day we were going to fly out. So I think it was like a Tuesday, Monday or Tuesday. And like DJ was there, Big Willie Leonard was there. And I go to take down DJ, and like he puts his knees up to like go back to guard, sort of. But like I fall on top of his knee, and like right in my stomach. It was like a one in a million shot, right? I'm like, ah, my stomach, it hurts so bad. And I'm like, okay, I must have got like hit in the liver or something. But like, you know, I'm like, man, I'm pretty tough. I took a liver shot with somebody's knee. I fell on top of it. So I was like, I just kept on going. And that was at the beginning of practice. So for the next 90 minutes, I was like going, like wrestling live with DJ and Willie. And like, if you don't know who Willie Leonard is, he's like a big, big dude, like 300 pounds. This big dude, probably more. Just a little bit more than 300. So for the whole practice. And at the end of practice, like my stomach really hurts, and like I fall over and like in the fetal position, and like I have to walk and like real slow to the locker room, and then I just lay down there for a while, and like one of my teammates is like, oh man, Tim, you okay? You probably just got hit in the belly button really hard. But I was like, man, like it hurts to breathe, it hurts. I couldn't even sit up straight, you know. So like, I call my mom, she drives me to the hospital, and they run all these tests, CAT scans, X-rays, you know. The doctor's touching it, and I'm in the emergency room for most of the night, and then they're like, okay, we're just going to take you under, we're going to put a tube down your throat or whatever, look in your stomach, see what's going on. Like, I'm thinking at worst I have a broken rib. So I wake up, and I got this long, like, cut in me, like, they stitched me up or whatever, and I'm like, what happened? And they're like, well, you had several ruptures in your colon, and you were bleeding out. Like, you were just leaking out.
Holy shit. So, internal bleeding.
Yeah, internal bleeding. So, like, I'm lucky because, like, I'm stubborn, but I'm not that stubborn. Like, I went to the hospital. So if I, like, went to Brasileiro's the next day, I would have probably died, like, on the flight. I was, like, leaking out. And, like, I was in the hospital for a week. Like, I couldn't use the bathroom. Like, physically unable to use the bathroom for about a week. It won't release me until, like, later on that week until I started using the bathroom and I could walk around more. But I was in the hospital about a week, and
they
said it would take me like 8 weeks to be able to train again. But I really want to thank my teammate Ty. He's like an older brother, Tyron Murphy. Like, he kind of like got me in the gym a little bit ahead of the curve. He's like, man, you got to get out there, you know. And then I fought my way back. So like that was last season, and this past brown belt season was my comeback. So that was like the only major injury I've had where I was down for a while.
Man, you hear about a lot of injuries. That's definitely a first.
Shit, man, I don't even know how to follow up to that. Well, you know what? Can we go back to training? Why in your opinion do you think jiu-jitsu is like the only sport out there where people train, you know, 8 to 10 hours a day, almost 7 days a week, almost 365? You know what I mean? Whereas, you know, hockey, there's an off season, you know, basketball player, et cetera, all that. Well, why is jiu-jitsu so different?
I think jiu-jitsu is so different as far as, like, hours you have to put in. It's a tough one.
Yeah, like, think about it. It's the only sport where people are, like, training, like, literally 7 in the morning till almost 9 at night, you know, whether it's strength and conditioning. Maybe it's not all jiu-jitsu, but it's jiu-jitsu related, you know, and it's they put their bodies, man, through the grind, like, for years. Like, Cabrini's been doing it for years. He's like, 36 or something. He's still doing it, you know?
I don't think it's any different than a lot of other sports. Like, from the more I train, the more I look, and, like, I know people that went through the All-American Wrestling, like, grind. I know a few judo Olympians, like, they train just like we do. I think with jiu-jitsu, it's a lot more, like, different than, like, I say basketball or whatever, because it's ever-changing. You know, like, with basketball, there's only so much you can do. You know, it's a team sport. Or football, but with jiu-jitsu, it's like it's head-to-head, and these guys are game-planning against you, and there's so much that goes into it, and it's a year-round sport. So if, like, say, for instance, if Rafa Mendez took time off like Peyton Manning did, where he'd take 3 months off and just go on vacation or whatever, Cabrini's training year-round, come Worlds, he's going to have to pay for it. So, like, jiu-jitsu is an arms race. You know, it's like he's getting better at this, and he's getting better at this, and, like, all year round, it's just building and building and building. Mm-hmm. And then it comes to Worlds, and then you shoot your shot. You know, so I think that has a lot to do with it, too.
As jiu-jitsu gets bigger, do you think that it should stay the way that it is, where there's not really an off-season, or would you like to see it kind of have an on- and off-season? Not to say that people necessarily stop training, but just, you know, kind of a competition season and a training season.
I kind of like the way it is now, with the competition season being year-round, so you can stay sharp. And if we want jiu-jitsu to grow, it has to be out there. Like, you look at the NFL, they're trying to expand the season. They're, like, trying to make the season longer. They make events out of, like, they might not play year-round, but they try to make it a big deal year-round. They'll have the draft. They pushed it back a little bit, and they make a big deal out of everything. I think if we want more eyes on the sport, the big names have to be out there a lot more often. Like, now, we already have a tough time, even in the season, having guys that are high level actually out there competing. Like, Pan Am's, it was a great tournament, but we didn't have all the heavy hitters out there. We didn't have Adolfo out there. We didn't have Buchecha out there, I don't think. Like, you know, we need, especially because we're a niche sport, all the big guys going out there and competing more often. So you can actually see them, and, you know, you can gather around them, and they can build a fan base, you know. So I think the year-round season is awesome, you know, especially if they start paying people, so mm-hmm. you get paydays more often. That's what I think.
Okay. So, speaking of paydays, so I wanted to talk a little bit about Copa Podio experience you had.
Mm-hmm.
You know, can you tell us how that came to be? Like, were you approached? Did you kind of campaign to get on that show? I mean, we had Travis Stevens on our show couple months ago, and he essentially just went on Twitter. Sorry, he went on Facebook and just said, "Hey, put me on. I'm good to go." Like, just something like that, I think. And next thing you know, he got invited. So, what was your journey onto that event?
I applied. Like, it was some weird, like, application process, and I was like, I saw the Master Lloyd. Hey, Master Lloyd, I really want to go on this. I want to test myself. You know, I want to fight all these guys. Like, I was a new brown belt at the time, but I was like, I'm the type of dude, I don't care. Like, at the end of the day, like, it's just the color of your belt. Like, fight to fight. So I'm going to go out there, and I want to test myself. So, you know, I send in my application, my very meager brown belt accomplishments or what have you, and then they accepted me, and I got out and got on the show.
And what was that experience like for you?
Yeah.
I liked it. It was pretty cool, you know. I felt like I had kind of arrived. Like, I was in the back room, like, warming up, and there was, like, guys that were, like, black belt world champions or high-level dudes when I was a blue belt, you know? Like, Leo Nogeira was back there, Rodolfo, like, when Rodolfo was, like, the king, like, won double gold at Worlds, I was a blue belt at that Worlds. And I was like, wow, you know? I was like, this is what hard work does for you, and you're on the same stage as them, you know? So it was amazing, you know. It's like kind of like if you get drafted into the NFL and it's like your first game, that was a feeling.
Yeah. Did you feel a little starstruck then?
Nah, not really. I was more excited to be able to fight him, you know.
Yeah.
I want to set my own mark. I don't want to, be all starstruck. I think that's the problem with a lot of guys. Like, they'll get starstruck out there and then they won't do their game. Like me, at the end of the day, I don't care what they did in the past. I don't care, like, what their name is, who thinks they can beat me. I'm going to go out there and do my thing, and I'm going to try to beat him. He's just, these other guys, I look at him as just another dude, just another opponent in front of me. And if I end up getting starstruck, it's going to affect how I perform. And at the end of the day, I want to win. So I'm not going to let anything mess up my mind.
That's kind of a cool thing about jiu-jitsu, too, is there's so many people out there that, like, I mean, you may not have any idea who they are. They've been training for years, and they might be amazing, and they come along, they beat one big guy, and all of a sudden they got a name for themselves.
I think that's really cool, too. You know, it's one of the few sports where you have a good chance, if you train real hard, to fight your idols one day. There's something really special about that, you know.
Yeah, and I mean, not to go too deep on the, I mean, on your match, because it was one that was lost, but the points doesn't really reflect the match, in my opinion. I mean, yes, you got your guard passed, but at the end, you kind of in guard. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, because you were there, obviously, but you were inside a closed guard, and you turned to go for a foot lock or something,
yeah,
which resulted in the 4 points. It was just kind of a do or die.
Yeah, I was like, do or die. I was like, okay. The foot's out there. I mean, might as well go for it, you know. Me winning on points was not going to happen. So I was like, I'm going to go for something and try to twist and turn it as hard as I can and go for the tap. Mm-hmm. Whatever happens, happens.
Yeah, it was an awesome match. So, yeah, for those who maybe haven't seen it, guys, you can find that out on – it's on Google. I mean, there's nothing illegal about it. It's out on Google if you guys want to check it out. It's a great match. You mentioned Leo V. I just want to make sure I'm not saying anything illegal. Like, I'm not like saying go download a UFC pay-per-view or something.
Yeah. They will find you. It's not a game anymore. Like,
no, I know that's serious business. So,
Ahmed's UFCstream.com.
No. But yeah, you mentioned Leo. Nogeira, and you're facing him on October 18th.
Yes, that's Saturday. Yeah. Yep.
You're right, Victoria. So that's about, I guess, about 3 weeks away. No, 4 weeks away, sorry.
4 weeks away.
Yeah, so not to divulge any of your secrets and all that, but when you're competing, like, when you're getting ready for a big super fight like that or for like the Copa Podio, do you enlist in some big name guys? Maybe do you travel to other camps? I don't know. You know what I mean? Like to get that level. That, I mean, Leo is pretty awesome, right? So.
Yeah, he's pretty good, yeah.
Yeah. But like, so I guess what I'm trying to do is say, like, do you find guys who are, like, really, really good who can, like, you know what I mean?
I don't go into any other camps, you know. I keep it all in Team Lloyd Irvin. Crazy 88, Third Law, and the Camp Spring Squad. Because on our team, like, we have elite athletes in different aspects of the grappling game. So, like... At Crazy 88, we bring in Kerry Chandler and Nick Del Popolo. Now, Nick Del Popolo is a judo Olympian. It's 2012 in London. He's very good. Arguably, in my opinion, he's the best American judoka we have that's currently competing. And he helped me a lot when I was starting to learn judo back when I was a blue belt. Like, I used to be a guard guy, and then he taught me some throws, and then I totally switched my game up to takedowns and guard passing. And I also, at Camp Springs, we have Sugi Damden, who's a judo world champion, and he's a two-time Olympian from Mongolia. So as far as the judo aspect, we're down with that. Like I said before, we got Chris Greg Howe, who wrestled for a very long time, collegiately at the Division I level, and he's helped me a lot with my grappling. As far as jiu-jitsu, I have the three best coaches in the game. I got Master Lloyd, I got Master Julius Park, and I have Master Donnie, who helps me a lot, too. And if you don't know who Master Donnie is, he runs the kids program at Team Lloyd Irvin, and he's brought kids up. Like, his jiu-jitsu knowledge is crazy. He's bringing kids up from little kids to, like, they're in the room with, like, me, DJ, Herberth, Gobi, Muhammad, all of us, and, like, we got to go 110%. And they're, like, 18, 19, 20 years old, and, like, blue belts, purple belts, and they're killers. So every day I'm in there with killers. I don't have to go anywhere else.
Okay.
So I just do the same thing I always do. I might, you know, focus a little bit more on this aspect than another aspect, but as far as going to other places, nah, it's all in-house. Don't go anywhere else.
So that kind of ties into a question I had. So on your website, you know, mm-hmm. you post a fair number of blog articles, and, you know, you're fairly outspoken. Yep. You posted an article not too long ago called "A Traitor by Any Other Name, Why Creontes Always Lose."
Yes.
And you took a fairly hardline approach against people who change teams there. So maybe could you just talk a bit about what kind of prompted you to write that, and then we'll go from there.
Okay. Well, what prompted me to go there was that I saw a lot of people, like, not just like big names, but just a lot of people in general, they switching teams, like hopping. And it wasn't like they were like, there's a few. I didn't go into depth in the article. You know, that's my only regret. Like, there are legit reasons for leaving. Like, if you move from, like, you live in Alaska or something, right? You go away to school in California, and it's a different school or whatever. I understand. Something like that. Or if you find, for some reason, you were at a McDojo. Like, you find out your instructor has no rank, doesn't know what they're talking about, what they're doing. You go to a different gym. But mainly what I was talking about was people that will leave a powerhouse, or they'll leave a team that brought them up from a little kid or from nothing to something, and they leave to another team that's high or from whatever bogus reason. And that's what prompted me to do this. And there's a lot of people that, you know, are famous in the game, or, you know, that don't get a lot of mention, that do the same thing. So that's what prompted me to do it. And I took a hardline approach because I'm a very loyal dude. You know, at the end of the day, I always rep my squad. I always rep Team Lloyd Irvin from beginning to end. That's who I started with. This is my ride or die. And it's kind of like repulsive to me that you would turn your back on people that brought you up. You know, for me, martial arts, isn't like a sport to me. Like, I grew up in the gym. Like, I saw when I was 16. Like, I was a little scrawny teenage kid. And, like, they're my family. So for me to leave, I could never imagine doing that. But for other people, you know, that aren't as loyal, they just leave. I mean, I think that's wrong. So that's what prompted me to write the article.
Are you directing more towards, maybe full-timers? Such as yourself, or is it like even casual guys like myself? Like, I only train maybe four times a week or something. Like, you know what I mean? Is it
in my mind? Is it full timers?
Okay,
all right. Mostly full timers, man. Like my view of it from the sport is more of like from a full time serious athlete aspect. Like, people that leave and like they're not serious and they just do it. Like, I find no problem wrong with that. You know, you're like a paying customer, but if you're a full timer. Like, a lot of the full-timers, like, I mean, I heard a lot of older guys, you know, old-school guys tell you, like, it's not the guys that pay that give you the most issues. It's the guys that you back or train full-time and don't have to pay that give the most issues. So that's who I was aiming the thing towards.
You know, full-timers.
You know, like, regular guys, like, you know, it's not like that to them. They're just doing it for fun. Guys that are going to worlds and putting their whole life on the line, and this is all they do, it's a little bit different.
Did this come up because a lot of people left Team Lloyd Irvin after those issues became very public?
Mm-hmm. So what was the question?
Well, the issues that became very public with Team Lloyd Irvin not too long ago, was that is this the article kind of came about because people left the Team Lloyd Irvin because of it?
I mean, it was a little bit from everything. You know, that's a part of it, but I mean, there have been creontes. I mean, back when Alliance, how those people left, that was a main aspect of the article for me, too. Like, it's always been a part of the game, and I just wanted to address it. But nowadays, it's getting more and more to the point where people are like, oh, it's okay. But to me, I come from, like, an old-school mentality. Like, I like the old-school jiu-jitsu. Like, I'm like, rah-rah, like, hardcore, this is my squad. And, like, I thought it was, like, weird. Like, when I was coming up, the idea was, like, kind of frowned upon. But now it's, like, everybody's cool with it. And it's just, like, it was weird to me. So that's why I wrote the article. And that's what it was directed towards. Like, modern day, kind of, like, it's kind of lost, like, the values.
But do you think that that's because our reality has changed? Like, you know, we're pretty far removed from the days of, like, the Alliance cross, a checkmate kind of split action. And I personally, I think that the nature of the sport has just changed at this point. I don't think, you know, like you made a mention in your article of, like, you know, going to a different team and then, you know, telling your new team about your old team's strengths and weaknesses. I mean, with everything being online now these days, is that even a thing anymore? Like, do you really have, you know, team secrets anymore when you can see pretty much any match or any opponent has ever done?
I mean, I think there's always secrets. I mean, if you go to a different team and they don't know certain aspects of the guy's game that you know, it's different if, like, you watch video of someone as opposed to if you're training with them for years. That's for one thing. The other thing is it's the principle. To me, it's the principle. Like you're just going to leave the team you've been with for so long, the people that had your back, like, to me, it's just silly. Like, why would you do that?
I think, you know, and not to get too deep into it, but I think when you look at, you know, the people that have left TLI, I think, you know, a lot of people left because of their principles, right? Because they didn't agree with the situation that was going on, and that's why they left. So, you know, I can see how that can be difficult for some people, you know, to balance those two. But, you know, I guess that leads into another question I had is, you know, is it difficult for you, you know, going to tournaments, competing with that, you know, I recognize that you're loyal to the people that you've trained with, the people that have brought you up, but, you know, you have to understand that, you know, repping Team Lloyd Irvin will paint you in a certain light, and people will look at you in a certain way. I mean, even us posting, you know, the notice of you being on the podcast, you know, prompted a number of people to send us some messages.
Yeah,
right?
People are giving me grief, man.
And these are people that don't know you, right? You know, and not that, you know, that you're a good athlete, but people will look at you in a certain light because of the team that you represent. And how is that something that's difficult for you? Is that something that is a challenge for you? It, you know, do you have to balance that with loyalty to the team that you rep?
I mean, first of all, I think that, like, the whole situation or, like, what people think goes on or went on, it's completely fabricated as far as, like, people thinking that we do this and that. Like, you know, bottom line is, you know, whatever jiu-jitsu media there is, they try to break up the team. They try to tear us down. They try to tear me down. Everyone else, associated, affiliated. But obviously, it's not working. It didn't work back then. It's not working now. People that left, addition by subtraction, because this past year, we had more world champions than before. We're getting stronger and stronger. We got more black belts on the mat. So as far as that's concerned, what other people have to say, I know what's going on. I know what's happened. And I have to say, like, I'm still with the squad, you know?
But you can't deny that there was a mass exodus from Cave Springs, right?
There was a mass exodus, yeah. But, you know, there are reasons, whatever people think it is or what people think about me. It don't really matter. It's all just whatever. You know, like, it's not real to me. As far as, like, people saying, like, our squad, the situation is a bad atmosphere or whatever people want to say, it's all hearsay. They left for whatever reason they are. I think the reason they left was BS. You know, I know the real reasons why they left, and the picture they try to paint to y'all, the jiu-jitsu media, it's completely different. I'm not going to go into detail, but as far as what people think about me, what team I represent, I don't care. I go out there and I represent the people that have my back from day one.
Do you, jiu-jitsu is, the jiu-jitsu community is a pretty small community, especially when you look at the competition scene. Like, I mean, it's even smaller. But do you feel like your relationship with other people within the community has changed because of your association?
I don't really have a relationship with people outside the inner circle. Like, I mean, I have, like, a passing, like, hi, bye, you know, how you doing? But as far as, like, you know, being close with them or whatever, I don't really notice anything different.
Going back to the creontes article really quick, because, well, we kind of talked about it, but the whole, do you think for the sport to grow, maybe this is a stupid question, and you can tell me if it's a stupid question, for the sport to grow, do you think, and especially if there's money to be made, like let's say like jiu-jitsu is not a business, do you think that trading and poaching will be a common practice going forward? So Atos picks up, they want Tim Spriggs, you come to Atos, and in return Atos will give, I don't know, you know what I mean, kind of like what we're seeing in other sports. Do you think, I mean, you see it in, I hate to make other, you know, references to other sports out there, like soccer. You have people who play for Man United who are not from Man United. You got people who play for Portugal who are Portuguese. Like it's something that's happening in other sports. And I was wondering if you thought that this might be something in the future that might happen.
No, there's not enough money in the sport to do that. No, not at all. Like the thing with like different sports is like, although like they have farm systems or they bring up athletes, it's a little bit different with sport jiu-jitsu because there's no backing. Like if you look at, like you mentioned Manchester United, they're sponsored by Chevrolet, right? They have the money to make these transfers, and like these guys are making hundreds of millions of dollars just to switch teams or whatever. There's no kind of money like that in jiu-jitsu. So as far as
I'm hoping in the future, maybe. I mean, we'll see maybe more pay-per-views, more Copa Podio, more Metamorphosis, more something where it becomes something more than what it is. Right now, jiu-jitsu, there's no money in it, I'm assuming, unless, like yourself, you teach, right, and you make a, you know, make a living that way. But I'm hoping in the future it develops. Maybe not in the next year or so, but you're right. There's no money right now. So it was kind of a dumb question. So
good question. Like, as people leave, like, people switching, like, for money, I don't know. I mean, it's, like, so far out of, like, where we're at now, I can't even, like,
fathom. Yeah, like, I would have to change. I'm just saying, like, let's say I start Ahmed's Jiu-Jitsu school, and I'm like, Tim, join my school. I'll pay you $50,000 or something. Like, that must happen. I'm assuming somewhere somebody is doing that. I don't know, because, you know, you represent me at World, and you make my school look good for business, because now I got a world champion, you know.
But, for, like, a lot of money, I think some people would do it.
Yeah.
I wouldn't do it, but, I'm a different type of dude, like, I'm not going to just leave my team just because for money or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Nah, so what about people that, you know, because I think you made mention of it in the article as well, about how, you know, when people leave to go to another team that they're never fully trusted by their teammates, you know, how do you does that cause issues? Because I'm sure that you guys have people that come out to train with you that leave other schools to train with you guys. So, you know, is it hard for you to, you know, integrate those people into your life, into your jiu-jitsu life, because knowing that they've left another team to come train with you?
I mean, whenever, like somebody new comes in, like, it's an adjustment. I'm not gonna lie. Like, yeah. I'm not a very trusting person by nature, so any new people I meet or anything, like, I'm like, what's this guy's angle, you know? Like, why are you here, you know? I mean, over time, you can build a relationship, but still, it's like, you know, what happened with all those dudes that I left is, like, I'm not getting fooled again. I'm not getting fooled into thinking, like, you're rah-rah, yeah, work for the team, because, you know, I mean, that's just how the fact of the matter is. You know, you'll notice, like, some of the most art, like, new guys were coming in, they were like, yeah, team so-and-so for life and everything, and then as soon as something happens, boop, gone. So, like, as far as me believing, like, they're all there, like, I'm kind of, like, not so trusting at first. It takes a while for me to trust, you know, new people that come in, you know. But, you know, that's not to say that the relationship can't change. We're still like, I mean, hey, you know, you left your other squad for us. Who's to say you're not going to leave us for somebody else?
Does the rest of your team like that? Do you feel like you guys are like a pretty tight-knit crew?
Oh, yeah, we're super tight. Like, everybody on my team, like, they're my best friends. Like, I don't have really a social life outside of my jiu-jitsu family. So this is all I got. So that's why I take this team and family stuff so serious.
Understand. We're going to move on to some questions from some people.
Cool.
Yeah, and these are some good questions. Maybe they'll develop more of a discussion. I don't know. But this one's from Yedril Rios. Sorry, guys. I don't know if I'm supposed to mention their name or not, but I just did. So this is a question. You asked the question. We're going to say who it's from. Who are you most looking to face now that you're a black belt?
I can't narrow it down to one person. I just want all the beasts. I want all the tough guys. When I go to Worlds this year, black belt, I want the toughest road. If I could have it any other way, I'd want, like, the top guys, just one after the other. Like Mortal Kombat, you know, how you gotta go up the ranks or whatever, or Tekken. I want that type of situation where it's like, this guy's really good, and this guy, you know. So I want all the tough guys, all the guys with all the accolades, I want everybody. So when I win, nobody can say that I had an easy road. So, I mean, I want all the tough guys at black belt. That's why I train so hard. I don't want it easy. I want to be able to say that I'm the best in the world. That's been my goal since day one.
Okay. And next question. So there'll be kind of rapid fire here. So what was your proudest BJJ moment, and what was your most disappointing?
My proudest was winning Worlds this year at brown belt.
Okay.
I worked really hard. I made a lot of sacrifices. I cried, like, away from everyone else. Like, after I won, I cried like a baby, because I came from being in a hospital for a week, could have died, to being at the top of the podium at a higher belt level, and knowing all that work, like people have no idea, like, how hard it was to, with everything that was going on, just to get to that point, just to get back, and then to be at my physical peak and all the tough, man, it's crazy.
So, yeah, but man, like, so that brings up a good question. I'm sorry, there was a two-part question about the most disappointing. But after winning Worlds at a black belt level, well, what more is there? Like, of course you could quadruple Grand Slam, I guess. But, like, well, what is your next big goal? You kind of won the Stanley Cup, so to speak. You know what I mean?
Just win a bunch more times until I'm gonna give the game up. Give the crown away. But I mean, right now my whole focus is winning black belt worlds. You know, me thinking about that far in the future. Like, the future is, like, you know, it has its place, but right now it's me getting that first title. You know, I mean, I'm like more of like a present guy. Like, I worry about what's going on right now. So right now it's just every day I'm going in the gym, you know, 110%. Trying to get to the world, win it. When I'm done, when I win all the world titles I don't want to win, I feel like I can't do it physically anymore, I just don't want to do it anymore, then I'll think about that. But, you know, I can't even think about what I would want to do afterwards. I'm living the dream now. Like, ever since I was a kid, I wanted to do this. Yeah. 16 years old.
And, so on that same question, the most disappointing.
The most disappointing. Okay. The most disappointing loss or whatever experience in jiu-jitsu would have to be when I was a blue belt and I lost at Worlds. It was 2011. And I was really upset because I worked really hard that year. I really wanted it really bad, and I just didn't get it done. So that's when I made the decision, like, I'm tired of coming to Worlds, not even getting a medal. I'm going to put my whole life into this so I can win. not just a blue, not just a purple, not just a brown, a black belt. Like, I was like, it's not a game anymore. I'm tired of losing. So I was just so frustrated, so upset, so disappointed. I just used that to fuel me. So that made me a stronger competitor, made me want to work harder. So whenever I feel like I don't want to train hard or whenever things get rough, I think about how I felt that day. Yeah. You know, just sitting there watching someone else get the gold medal that I wanted really bad. So that was my most disappointing.
Adam, do you...
Oh, yeah, I've got another question. I'm just trying to find it here.
That's okay, because I have more. Oh, you got it up? Okay.
Tim, this question's from Bashir Abdi, hashtag Bashir, shout out.
Hashtag Bashir.
Is it true in 2012 you were studying at a university and training for competitions both? And if so, how were you able to balance them both and still manage to do well in major competitions?
That is true. Absolutely. I was training and being a full-time student at St. John's University in Queens, New York. How was I able to do it? Well, I was lucky because we live in the age of YouTube, and I used to watch as many jiu-jitsu fights as possible. So I would watch every fight I could find online. I looked up all the guys that were winning at the moment. I tried to, you know, emulate them. So whenever I did have the chance to train with someone, I would do it. I would do what they did, and I would do, like, workouts on my own. Always make sure I was in shape. Always make sure I ate pretty clean as a college student could, you know. Try not to party too much because, you know, college is crazy. But, so that was a juggling act. But, you know, like being successful, I mean, I think what really helped as well was whenever I had breaks, I would come back home and train 2-3 times a day, like as much as I could. Like summer vacation, spring break, winter break, whenever I could get home, I would go home training.
Okay. Another question from Justin Nero. Do you ever plan on opening your own school or academy in the future?
Not at the moment, no.
Well, no, not now. I mean, you're still young. But, I mean, let's go to 30. You know, let's say 7 years from now. Like, no ambition, zero at all. Or...
After working in a gym for a while and knowing what goes into it and making it successful, like anybody can open a gym, you know, but making it successful and making it a good environment. Nah, I mean, I don't want to have to deal with those headaches. You know, I don't have to deal with all the drama that has to go into it, all the trouble. No, I'd rather do something else than have to run a school. Yeah, I would want to find something else to do than run a school.
And a final question, and it's a little lengthy, so I'll bear with me here. Crazy 88 has quietly been one of the most successful teams of late. I believe you guys had 6 or 7 medal at Worlds in the last 2 years. This is amazing considering you guys aren't in a major metropolitan area and most of your talent is homegrown. So the question is, what do you guys do that separates you from other competition-oriented schools? Please be specific so I can bite it. That's what somebody said, so they can steal your idea. But they were just joking, they said. But yeah, the question is, very verbose, but what do you guys do that separates you from other competition-oriented schools?
I don't really look at it as, you know, separated as far as, like, Crazy 88 from Their Law or from Camp Springs. Like, I look at it as, like, all of Team Lloyd Irvin, we've been killing the competition scene, like, killing it. Like, this last year alone, we're on the podium all the time. Like, I mean, what separates us is that we train harder. We got a bunch of killers on the mat all the time. And we just have a different mindset. We're hungry, you know. That's what separates us. Because everyone knows the moves. At the end of the day, there's only so many jiu-jitsu moves. There's only so many techniques. There's only so much you can do. You just got to be willing to grind it out more. You got to be willing to sacrifice more. And the proof is on the mat. I mean, it's nothing special, you know. I told you, my training schedule and everything, like, it's nothing special. It's just that. We're doing what needs to be done. We're doing what's necessary. I can only speak for myself, and me personally, I make the most of everything at my disposal. You know, most of the training partners, most of the environment, you know, and when I go out on the mat, I just go in kill mode, kind of, you know, like, I just want to go out there and win, and it's just instilled in me since I started with this team, like, you go out there, you don't care who it is in front of you, you do your job, you do what you've been training to do, you stay focused on your systems, good things happen, and that's what we've been doing so far.
All right, well, it's obviously been paying off for you. You've had a very successful last couple of years, particularly in the Grand Slam events. Really, finally, just final question, what's the next, after the super fight, what's your next tournament that people can expect you to be at?
After my super fight, I'm fighting Copa Podio against Lucas Barbosa, also known as Lucas Hulk, on November 22nd. It's going to be on the Copa Podio pay-per-view. It's a part of the USA versus Brazil face-off.
Nice.
And I'm going to bring it home for America in spectacular fashion. So that's what's after the Leo Nogeira match. And as far as Leo Nogeira is concerned, I fully plan on winning and showing everybody that I'm the best in the world. And that's what I believe with all my heart. So please tune in, you know, watch me, you know, all my fans out there. Thank you for all the support. You know who you are. You know, keep watching. You know, I'm gonna make you guys very entertained. So that's what it is. Awesome.
Okay, and finally, I've said finally three times. Finally, any sponsors or anything you'd like to shout out before we call an end to it?
Yeah, there's a lot of people I want to thank. First, I want to thank my gi sponsor, Ronin Brand. We got the best gis. A lot of people don't know about Ronin Brand, but those are gis I always wear. They're super comfortable. They look just swagged out, man. That's all I can say. They're a really awesome sponsor. Thanks, Doug. I want to thank my coaches. I want to thank Julius Park. You know, he brought me up from not knowing any jiu-jitsu to being who I am today, you know, taking me under his wing, giving me opportunity to make jiu-jitsu my life. I want to thank Master Lloyd for helping me. You know, he's like another father figure to me, just like Julius is. You know, he's always down to talk to me. He's always trying to help me. You know, this past year, you know, he took me under his wing. He helped me out a lot. You know, I mean, he's like the best coach in the world. You know, he definitely changed my whole perspective on the jiu-jitsu game. Helped me a lot. Thanks, Master Donnie. He's the best kids coach in the world, and he helps me a lot with me coaching my kids in the program. You know, he doesn't usually get a lot of credit, but I want to give him credit. I want to thank my training partners, DJ Jackson, Isaac Easton, Sajara Eubanks, Herbert Santos, Gobi Amelson, and Muhammad Ali. Those guys, they bring the pain every day, you know. I wouldn't be as good as I am now if it weren't for them pushing me to the limit every day. A really important one is Nico Popolo for showing me judo, Sugi Damden for helping me a lot, Coach Greg Howe for helping with strength conditioning, as well as my wrestling, and Coach Jamal Hargrove for always having my back as well. You know, all the guys at that Fighter House, James Vick in the UFC, Sadiq Youssef, you know, all those guys, just want to say thank you. And, you know, just go out there and, you know, when I'm out there on the mat, I'm by myself, but with y'all's support, I feel like I can take on the world, and so far I have, so thanks to you guys.
All right.
Well, thanks a lot, Tim, for coming on and sharing some of your stories with us. Good luck at your upcoming super fights, and I'm sure we'll be hearing your name a lot more soon.
Thanks for having me.
No problem. And just for the people out there, next week, guys, tune in for Dante Leon, probably one of the, you know, top purple belt out there right now. After that, we've got, AJ Agazarm. That's all off memory. Sorry, AJ Agazarm, followed by George Burrito, followed by, I forget. I don't know, man. Jeez. Who else? Adam, help me out.
We'll post it on the website. Don't worry.
Yeah, we'll post it on our website. Yeah. Oh, Carbillido. I can't pronounce his last name. Forget it. Just check it out. We'll post it later.
Let's just let Ahmed struggle.
Yeah. Anyway, there's a bunch of people. Whatever.
All right, so that's it for episode 3. Tune in next week, and we'll talk more.
Peace. Nice.